Hello everyone and welcome to the Dead Horse Podcast. With me today is Rashi.
Hi.
And Vivek.
Hey.
And I'm Arvind, in case you didn't know. Today we are going to talk about two games. The first one is Brothers, A Tale of Two Sons. And the second one is, it's like Uncharted / Tomb Raider, the new one kind of thing. You just combine the discussions.
There's no / Tomb Raider, just, oh, okay, yeah, fine. Uncharted / Tomb Raider.
Yeah, yeah, I mean, that's
all. I understood what you were saying just after you said it.
Yeah.
it's a discussion of Nathan Drake versus Lara Croft.
No, I mean, not really. We don't want to have that discussion. It's like games in that mold, because a lot of character driven games feel like they are sort of in that mold where it's like,
you know what, we should discuss? We should discuss that game Unearthed, The Trail of Ibn Battuta.
What game is that?
What?
You guys haven't seen this?
No.
Oh, man.
I heard that game before, but somebody told me there's some game with this kind of a weird name, and I'm like, okay, I don't know.
It is. It's basically a game made by a studio in Saudi Arabia. It's Uncharted-ish, but not with the name of Uncharted. Like it's set in Saudi Arabia. It's not very, like, the production values obviously aren't of the same level. Here I put a link to it. You guys can check it out.
Oh, I see. Yeah. Oh, I saw the Steam page of this, and like the reviews were not very complimentary, so I sort of skipped on it.
Yeah. No, I haven't played it either. Yeah.
So anyway, okay, let's start with Brothers, A Tale of Two Sons. Yeah, because I always get. Vivek, what do you have to say about the game?
It's a good game when it's not. See, the problem with Brothers is there are moments where, like, you know it's trying too hard. When, like, the music amps up and, like, there's this whole thing going on in the background. Oh, look at the deep meaning of what we were trying to do. And you realize, okay, fine. I got it 5 minutes ago. You didn't need to beat me over the head with emotions.
When did this exact moment happen? Because I am actually surprised to hear you saying it, because this feels like something I would say, but I don't have anything to say about like that. So when did this happen exactly?
You know the ending part in Brothers where he comes back and
wait,
his brothers.
Wait.
Oh,
are you
sorry.
Spoil it. Oh my god. Okay, fine. Go ahead with it. It's okay.
I
don't think it was spoiled enough. So yeah, we are still safe. But okay,
the Valley of Giants and the moment in the cave. You know what I'm talking about? Just before the end when
That felt very, now that you mention it, that was kind of ham-fisted,
Yes.
Okay. In fact, like, plot twist was kind of weird. Like, I won't go any further than this, but yeah, that plot twist didn't sit right with me.
Yeah. My favorite moment in Brothers is when you're exploring the giant's house, the empty giant's room in the castle. That is my favorite moment in that game. Yeah. It's not trying too hard there. It's just like, this is the world you're in. And it's great at world building. You feel like you're in a Brothers Grimm fairy tale, you know?
Yeah.
Oh, that's definitely true.
Yeah.
Rashi, what do you think of the game?
I have just started playing the game, and definitely I do get confused while playing on the PS3 controller, because, you know, you have to use both the sticks to control both of the boys. So it gets a little, confusing at that moment. But otherwise, I think the game is pretty fantastic.
I personally, I felt the control scheme was absolutely perfect for the game. Like, and I think even the PC version, like, it is possibly the only game on Steam which says like controller required to play. And I can actually see why they did that, because
like I don't mind
especially like some elements of the game. And,
well, the good part is
Okay, someone
the good
needs
part
to
is I own it
Hello?
On both PC and I own it in on both PC and PS3, so I can definitely, you know, try and play the PC version as well and see what differences are there with the keyboard version. But otherwise, I think it'll take some getting used to. But I think it's pretty simple. I mean, just one or two buttons required, and the joystick only is required to move around. So that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
I mean,
it
it's okay
different.
If you guys want to spoil it, you can. It's fine.
No. I think let's because the only the two key things which I think make the game is the first, the control scheme, which is absolutely like perfect for that game, and it's a new way of controlling characters.
Oh, definitely.
So, I mean it's rare because I didn't think somebody could reinvent controller controls like what how they did. So I mean, it was a very pleasant surprise. And it shows like even like these devices have been here for like 10, 15 years. And still people can find new ways to use them.
Yeah.
And the second thing was like, for most of the game, the understated nature of the control. Like, there's a ton of details on the side, but nothing is spoken. Everything is just implied. So the lack of, like, the music is good, but there's no voice. And that actually works for
me. There is a voice, but everything that's spoken is in an unintelligible
language.
Yeah,
it's like Simlish, I guess, kind of.
Yeah.
Initially, you know, they started out, you know, gibbering some language, and my sister was like, "What language is that? Why doesn't it have subtitles?" And initially, even I was confused, but then I found. I mean, I was like, okay. You know, you just need to see, you know, it's gestures and everything. They'll just explain it to you somehow and you'll understand. And that's what the beauty is of the game. I mean, it was quite nice to see that.
I think we should definitely resume this discussion once, like, Rashi finishes playing the game. Because there's a ton of... Yeah, go ahead.
Like, one of the interesting things about Brothers that I found is that, like, it's made... the game director is a film director. And he's a pretty prominent film director in Sweden, I think.
Yeah.
And like he's made hit films there, and this is his first game. Like it's weird that someone who's from a medium that is almost the polar opposite of ours can do such a good job basically through systems.
Yeah, though I don't think he was the only person who made this. I think Starbreeze.
Starbreeze, but like he decided almost everything from the control scheme. To you know, the story and stuff like that. It's his baby.
I can definitely understand because that sort of control scheme sort of takes a person who isn't versed in the language of games.
And the other, because for people like us who are kind of steeped in the language of games, like we would never do a control scheme like that. It would be like, how does the camera work? You know, like this is no player will be able to do this. It takes that perspective. It's really interesting. Like, you guys should read. There's a pretty good article on Polygon, I think, about, you know, why he made the game and what it's about.
I read that to be
He's originally from Iran, and I think, I can't even say what he made the game about because that spoils the game.
I'm telling you, I mean, go ahead. It's okay. I mean, I don't mind.
Let's stop this discussion. But I will say that I am looking forward to the Mario-themed sequel, Brothers: A Tale of Two Plumbers.
Oh yes, that would be fun.
That would be awesome.
So let's move on to our next topic, which is this thing can be called a genre now? Third-person character-driven shooty cover games or something? Because
it's third-person action adventure, I guess.
I mean, action adventure is such a
third person Gears of War adventure. Gears adventure is what I'd call it.
Though, I mean, I was just looking at the
I have Adventure Gears. Adventure Gears. That's what I'm sure. I have it. Perfect.
I was looking at a video by Super Bunny Hop, who was discussing Resident Evil 4. And he highlighted how Resident Evil 4 sort of started the whole third-person shooter kind of trend thing, which was then incorporated by Gears of War.
Sure.
Yeah.
Like the third-person shooter took off after Resident Evil 4 came out. That is that's definitely like a seminal game in the history of like this generation. It's influenced a lot of games that came after it.
And it really,
did Resident Evil 4 come before or after Tomb Raider 1? The original Tomb Raider.
Oh, much after.
Yeah.
Okay.
Tomb Raider is positively ancient, like compared to Resident Evil 4.
Compared to Resident Evil 4, yeah.
Hmm.
Resident Evil 4 is a GameCube game. So,
yeah.
Like, Tomb Raider 1 is PS1, I think. PS1.
Tomb Raider had a really different control scheme. I mean, I personally remember that, like, I was unable to play those games because, like, the camera was sort of independent of your movement completely. So, like, you could just sort of... Yeah, it was weird how that game worked.
Had this weird lock-on system as well. Like, all I remember about that is that I used to shoot wild animals in it. A lot of wild animals.
Yeah.
That game is basically, for me, it's me shooting tigers. The old Tomb Raider.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. almost all Tomb Raiders had tigers. In fact, I was kind of disappointed the latest Tomb Raider didn't have tigers in it.
It actually could have. Like, the weird thing about the new Tomb Raider is that it has almost every climate type in it other than desert. You have jungle, you have rainforest.
I missed the lava level in the middle somewhere.
Oh, but lava is not like a terrain type.
Yeah, I know.
There's snow in the end.
One thing which really strikes me as weird is that like this island is probably like it's a really big island. It's it's almost Sri Lanka sized. But you kill like about 50 million or so people. And nobody sends in a rescue team at some point or something.
Oh, they do, but the plane crashes, right?
Yeah,
I know. No, but I mean, like, send a proper rescue team instead of one plane, which, like, I mean, what kind of a plane just crashes simultaneously?
I don't know. Like, the weird thing about Tomb Raider, the weirdest thing I thought about Tomb Raider was that, of like, you know, 90% of the people who have, like, not even 90, 100% of the people who have crashed there before Lara Croft and her crew, are homicidal maniacs.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
That's really, really weird. Like, it's like when humans are marooned and they crash somewhere, the first
you
thing
mean, even
not...
when men are marooned?
Yeah.
Because they're all men.
Men are
pretty sure they got
place.
Very frustrated.
Oh my God, yeah.
That explains a little bit, I suppose. But like, the first reaction isn't to help each other out. The first reaction is, let's go Lord of the Flies on each other, guys.
Yeah, I guess all of those... like maroon people must have been from Delhi or someplace.
Oh
God!
No, but really, like because like the logical thing I would expect is to be some kind of a tribal type society structure there. Where,
and
like,
that's really similar to the people in Delhi, right?
Okay. Let's.
I thought you were going to logically explain a racist reason for why people in Delhi would murder each other if left alone.
It's not racist. Some of my best friends are from Delhi.
I'm from there as well, but yeah, I hate the place.
Delhi. He has really good food.
No, I mean, so the point being that, yeah, I mean, it feels very video gamey, like the whole island's sole purpose of existence is to provide Lara Croft with obstacles.
With people to kill, punch arrows into.
And one thing which I find really weird, which I don't know, is that the first hour of the game is completely at odds with the other hours of the game.
The first hour is almost like it's going to be a horror exploration experience.
Yeah.
And the rest of the game is Lara Croft shooting people with guns.
Yeah. I mean, according to the writer, Nehana Pratchett, she said that the reason for this was that the game was already set when she was brought on the team, and she was like, and she was told to basically, okay, this is the story that Lara Croft is, the story which is like Lara Croft is a relatively sheltered teenage archaeologist which is weird. I'm gonna get back to that, but yeah. So like this is the story that she goes from there to badass Lara Croft, and the game is shooting people. You just somehow incorporate it. So that was the result of that was why the first star was had sort of. Because really the character development is like the first half has about 90% of the arc and the rest of the game is the final 10% of the arc of the game.
In a way, I feel Far Cry 3 covered the whole island story better than Tomb Raider does. I mean, you know, the people living on the island, it explains it a little better. In fact, the only thing I didn't like about Far Cry 3 was the fact that the protagonist is basically, you know, this teenager who suddenly becomes Rambo, you know. I just couldn't swallow that fact.
He becomes Rambo in 5 minutes.
Yeah, exactly.
It does not take very long for him to become Rambo.
Yeah, I mean, Lara Croft at least took an hour. But that guy just picks up his first gun and is like, yep, like completely.
Headshot time.
Yeah, I guess that's why like the US people are so keen on the Second Amendment and everything. Yes, you just can hand anyone an assault rifle and they'll just clean out
start
the entire island. Yeah.
Start putting random indigenous people from some island they've been to for the first.
Just
to remind our audience, some of Vivek's best friends are indigenous people.
This is true. Some of my best friends are indigenous people.
One thing which these games do have a problem with is the an arc kind of the origin story arc, if you will, where the protagonist goes from everyday person to
next door to
I don't know what demigod, like basically a demigod.
Wonder Woman.
Well, I think the tagline of Tomb Raider is a survivor is born, right? So she's just from normal human being to survivor, which I guess in video game language is someone who can murder 500 people and be okay with it.
And like take 500 or so bullets and just like be okay.
Shrug them off.
So that was
and
wearing a vest.
Lara Croft's case get impaled with alarming regularity.
Yeah.
Oh
so
yeah, there was just too much violence in the game.
Yeah.
I mean, every time she's
that
just falling down somewhere and breaking a bone or something, she gets impaled by a spike. Nothing happens. She gets up. She's like, oh my god. She just holds it for like 5 minutes, and then the next thing you know, it's she's okay. She's jumping like crazy.
The cure to being impaled by a spike
is
big time events.
Yeah.
I mean, it knocked out Joel in Last of Us, but in Tomb Raider, Lara Croft is like, yeah, whatever. She suddenly forgets about it.
Fundamentally different games, though. Like, but yeah, Lara Croft is stronger than Joel. There's no doubt about it.
Yeah, I mean, it really, the game does have sort of a... And I personally think that game's impact would have been much better if you just halved the number of people you had to kill. And two made it flat. Because really, like at the end, the body count sort of starts getting into insane levels where, like, it sort of destroys the whole setting. Because, like, we were discussing earlier, like, why are so many people on one island? Why hasn't anybody asked any questions? Why haven't more rescue teams showed up?
But then, is there an Uncharted as well? Like, you know, suddenly there's like this whole army of these weird people. You know, and you have to shoot them. And if you don't move out of that place, they'll keep on coming, and they'll keep on coming, and you have to eventually just, you know, you get sick of it and you just move off.
Yeah.
I don't know how many people she hired in Uncharted.
That's weird, because at some point, somebody would have noticed that, hey, our population suddenly got reduced by half. And somebody
There's this excellent Penny Arcade comic about that, where Nathan Drake is basically shooting those guys and, like, eventually he asked them, guys, you guys are getting like, I mean, you guys have health insurance and stuff, right? You're covered for all this. Because otherwise it's really not worth it. And then like the guys whom he's shooting at decide to unionize at the end. One of Penny Arcade.
I mean, definitely won't single out Tomb Raider for this. Like pretty much, I guess this is one thing where like games are sort of struggling right now. Is that like, you want the action that was in the Doom era. But at that time, there was no story. So it just made sense. Okay, what the hell? It's demons.
Yeah, like I think Bulletstorm or a Serious Sam game can get away with it. But a game that's supposed to be deep and like story and emotions does not get away with it. Like
Yeah,
you
that's
can't
what.
like you can't get away with it in a like you can get away with it even in the Gears of War, but you can't get away with it in a like in a Tomb Raider or a
Yeah.
BioShock Infinite.
I mean, Gears of War in even though it might sound like I'm defending it, but really Gears of War does not have any pretensions to some sort of higher art form. And like the
You haven't
story
played
in
the
Gears of
second game.
War is absolutely like crap. Like it's just nothing. It's just like smash one girl and then just like they just sort of and
You haven't played the second game. The second game has an obnoxious plot. Like, literally,
oh.
the end of the second game is you find a concentration camp. I'm not joking. You find a concentration
Yeah,
camp.
I guess if that game would have come out now, it would have been slaughtered. But like when it was coming out, nobody really cared about plot and
Oh
everything.
man, like I remember Cliffy B saying shit like, I cried when I saw the ending of Gears of War 2. It's really emotional. We've gone to the next level with our plot. And I was like, why the fuck are you doing that? It's a dumb action movie. It's not supposed to be this great Greek tragedy. It's Die Hard, man. Just have guys shooting each other. That's what Gears of War is about. It's not about some story.
And I think, like, funnily enough, like the original, the first Die Hard had a very low body count for John McClane. Like, I remember reading somewhere it was like 16 or so people, like
Yeah,
which.
it's under 100 for sure.
No, I mean, like, really, it's like
And then
it's
people
below
complain
20.
about George R.R. Martin.
No, I mean that's a different kind of body count where like people get killed due to like intrigue and stuff like that, not really like one person with a sword just killing everyone. But yeah. So
So,
yeah,
like,
like I guess what these games are is that these games have a conflict inside with their like on one hand they want to be like fun like and be like 20-hour enjoyment for all your family kind of events. But on the other hand, they also now especially want to like have higher aim higher, tell a touching story. And like really there are not a lot of stories which can be told where the protagonist like murders 500 or more people. So
that really sounds so wrong.
yeah.
like I like is there a way to do that, like make you a protagonist who murders 500 people, acknowledge it, and to make that story work?
I mean,
Would have to be a story about someone who just basically ends up with like ends up in an insane asylum because of PTSD, right?
I mean, I guess if you look at the games who like I'm just like saying this did it sort of successfully, and the only way they did it was by like having absolutely no like pretensions about where they are coming from. Like God of War, for example.
Oh yeah.
Like from the first moment, you know that like you are in this game to like just like murder people in the most brutal way possible. And
And
Kratos is
Kratos is an
not
asshole,
likable. Yeah.
so that helps.
That guy is not likable. That guy like is never the good guy. That guy, like everything is his fault. And he's just this complete selfish.
He's just
Yeah.
angry. He's just like Hulk who can't change into
Yeah.
Hulk.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah. So yeah, I mean I guess but even I mean God of War never like had any complex plot. Like the plot in God of War just serves to give you a bigger set piece than the last one. Like that's the reason for the plot. And that's why I think like the series sort of like should have ended at 3. Because at the end of 3 there is no bigger god to kill. You just like kill the biggest god of the big gods. So
But it's like a prequel, right? So he hasn't killed the big god yet.
yeah, but I mean really, why do you want to go back to a smaller god once you've killed the bigger one? So yeah, that's why I don't know, like the prequel idea is just weird. I
The
mean, I
first
don't
suggestion, I think, after God of War 3 ended, like the first suggestion I heard from a lot of people was that he should go after the Hindu pantheon in the next game. And I thought that's not the best idea, man.
I mean, like you could do it, but like you like I mean I would be like I would play that game, but I wouldn't play that game as Kratos. I would want a protagonist that's like from the Indian pantheon. rather than like, because Kratos is a Greek guy, he would stand out like a sore thumb in the setting.
True.
Yeah, he would.
Yeah, he
It would
would.
not make sense. That would be a weird game, if it is Kratos
Yeah.
going after the Hindu
I
pantheon.
wonder what his
Because
Indian counterpart would be called.
I don't know.
oh man, Ramdas? I don't know.
No, I mean, it has to be angry. Like Kratos, like sounds very angry, like kind of. So yeah, I have absolutely no idea because
Vijay,
he.
like that is Amitabh Bachchan's name when he was the angry young man, so Vijay.
Yeah, but I mean, I don't know. Like yeah, I mean, like I can see a guy named Vijay killing 10 people, but like 500 gods or so, probably not.
That's fair
So
enough.
yeah, I mean yeah, they because.
Karan, there you go. Karan is someone who can kill 500 gods,
No,
and
not
there's
really.
like
I mean,
mythological reference there.
wasn't that guy supposed to be some like noble kind of
Seriously,
person?
let's brainstorm what the story is about. Karan has just died and gone to heaven. He's pissed off that the gods have let the Pandavas win, so he's murdering Indian gods. Done.
Yeah.
No, I would actually set the story with Ghatotkach because that guy actually like makes more sense.
That makes more sense too. That
Yeah.
works.
Because like he was like this half demon kind of guy, and he is bigger than the rest, and you can sort
Yeah.
of like add like skill trees and stuff to it because he was relatively untrained
And
compared
you
to the
can
rest
link
of them.
it to Chota Bhim.
Oh
No,
God.
no, yeah, you just ruined
What's
it. You
going
just ruined
on,
it.
my dude? Like, we just made the dark, gritty version of Chota Bhim. Like, this is not Chota Bhim, this is Bhim Junior. But
Oh my God. Yeah. You just
yeah.
completely ruined this game forever. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, like what an equivalent of this is? Like somebody looks at Captain America 2 and the guy's like, you know what? We need Jack Sparrow in that movie. That's what you
Oh
did right now.
God.
Yeah,
Oh
that's what
God.
you did. Yeah, that's what you
Hey man, I did some brand synergy is what I did. You know, that's what
did.
they call it. I saw that you were creating an IP, and I saw a brand that you could leverage to make that IP popular, and I did some synergy, you
Shut
know.
up, shut up, and go make a free-to-play game or something. Oh yeah, anyway, Roller Coaster Tycoon 4, just out of the blue. Any thoughts about
No.
No.
it?
What the hell?
Any thoughts about it that like you might not like say in public?
No.
No.
Okay. So anyway, yeah, it's a microtransaction-laden mess. Has absolutely zero strategy. The layout of your part doesn't matter. And yeah, like please stop making these games, industry. Please just listen to us this one time. Don't listen to the previous version. What we said. Listen to this. What I'm saying. That
I
please
think there's a
stop.
better chance of my God of War game called Chota Bhim God of War coming out. Seriously.
Yeah, and
Bhim
that's why.
Junior. Like,
Yeah, that's why this
that's.
industry is ruined. Yeah.
Yeah. Totes excited for Bhim Junior. Civilization Beyond Space.
Yes, Civilization Beyond Two Souls. No way.
Is that
Oh
Beyond Two
God.
Souls? What is it?
No, Beyond Earth.
Beyond Earth.
Yeah. Rashi, have you heard of this?
No, I have actually not heard of many latest
Oh.
game news.
Okay. So are you aware with Alpha Centauri? Like a previous, like it's a classic game of like Civ, you know, stuff. Okay, but anyway,
Yeah.
Firaxis are making a new civilization game, and it's set
The
in,
trailer is really awesome.
yeah, space.
True.
It's set in space.
Yes, you can
Oh.
colonize other planets and crazy stuff happens.
And we can
You know, people.
be
Yeah, go ahead.
who's that guy? Who's that guy from with the Silver Surfer? Who's that guy? Galactus.
Galactus. Yeah, Galactus.
Galactus, yeah. Somebody should do that.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure like once they add Steam Workshop support, like somebody will just make a faction called Galactus. Because there are already like in Civ 5, there's a faction for I think like several game characters. I can't remember them off the top of my head. But yeah, there are several game characters. There was one Johnny Bravo faction, which I find really weird. Like,
Oh,
how would the Johnny
oh my
Bravo
God,
faction play?
that would be epic. I
No,
would totally join that.
I mean not join that, but you play as the Johnny Bravo civilization. So kind of like that. So I'm not sure of what that civilization's properties would be. So, what would that civilization do?
Teach each other how to, pick up girls, maybe, I don't know. Pick up lines.
I mean, I didn't really watch Johnny Bravo all that much, but I think his lines failed, right? It's like his lines never succeed.
Obviously, Johnny Bravo
Yeah.
is.
So
I
he's a
mean,
loser,
like,
right?
yeah.
Yeah. So like the worst faction ever. But yeah. So I mean, yeah. Once like you open the like modding gates, like anything is possible.
Shit will go crazy eventually.
Yep, totally.
That and the other strategy game I'm excited for that's come out this year or it's going to come out is Crusader Kings 2 Rajas of India.
It's released, I think. It's
Oh, it's
sort of
released.
a DLC which adds India.
Yep. You have three different new kinds of kings now. You have Jains, Hindus, and Sikhs.
Yeah.
Yeah, because they already have Muslim kings in the old expansion.
Yeah, it has a surprisingly like I mean it was a surprise to me sort of, but I mean I guess yeah they did the research, but like they have a surprisingly brutal view of the kings except Jains, because Jains are like total peaceful, like chill
Yeah.
out kind of
They're
bros.
pacifistic, right? Like
Yeah,
they cannot
they're
attack anything,
yeah.
they cannot kill anything.
Yeah.
Right.
Which is really weird, because like how would that work in Crusader Kings? I'm really
It's
interested in
the
knowing.
weirdest thing is, that's a very like rare example of a pacifist civilization from ancient times surviving till this day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I mean like
I they must have
similar.
adapted. They must have had an army of
Yeah.
some sort. They cannot have
Yeah.
survived purely on just being nice people.
Yeah.
Because that doesn't make sense in the world we live in, right?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, like I don't know how they managed it, because really, I mean, I don't know. Like I guess I'll have to look them up, like how they did it.
Yeah, I think that's about it though. We should call it for this week, right, Arvind?
Hey everyone, thank you for listening to the Dead Horse podcast for this week. We were Rashi
Yo.
and Vivek.
Ciao. See you guys.
Bye.
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 Later.